This week, Melissa McCarthy gets serious in a memorable dramatic role. A family laughs and cries its way through the challenges of Alzheimer's, and Rowan Atkinson returns as the secret agent, Johnny English. I'm Bill Newcott, film critic for the Saturday Evening Post. All that, plus comedian Dennis Miller takes a sting at the Wasp Woman. On this week's podcast, Movies for the Rest of Us.
Nobody is going to pay for the writer Lee Israel right now.
I'm months behind in my rent, and my cat is sick.
It's 4 in the afternoon, and you're drunk.
I'm hardly drunk.
Crazy.
Few people have made us laugh more reliably than Melissa McCarthy, whose string of hit movie comedies stretches back for the better part of a decade. So you might not be prepared for her latest movie, the absorbing drama, Can You Ever Forgive Me? She plays the late Lee Israel, a successful writer of biographies who, when she fell upon hard times, started forging documents from famous writers like Lillian Hellman and Noel Coward.
This is quite something. He's a wonderful.
I thought so too.
Name your price.
Because it's Melissa McCarthy we're talking about, you'd expect this to be some sort of hilarious caper film. But instead, she paints a heartbreakingly tragic portrait of a woman who, while she loves to delve into the minds of dead writers, finds it nearly impossible to relate to other human beings. Even to the end, Lee is barely repentant for her literary crime spree. But in answer to the film's title, thanks to Melissa McCarthy, yes, all is forgiven.
I can't say that I regret any of my actions. In many ways, this has been the best time of my life.
Nikki, what do you mean she's gone?
She was trying to go home. She thinks she's still a little girl and she can't figure out why she's stuck here.
You ought to be home with your family.
Is she all right?
She's fine.
Blythe Danner is a woman with encroaching Alzheimer's disease, and Hilary Swank and Michael Shannon are her bickering kids in What They Had, a heartfelt and surprisingly funny family drama from writer-director Elizabeth Chomko.
I don't think there's a family in this country that's not touched by Alzheimer's or dementia of some kind. And I'm wondering if you brought some of that to it, some personal...
Oh, definitely. Yeah, of course, yes. It's inspired. My grandmother was diagnosed with Alzheimer's about 17 years ago.
Oh, wow.
She was 68. She was quite young. And, you know, it was devastating. My family, a family of laughers. We were always laughing about, you know, we didn't take anything seriously and except for, you know, Catholicism. And, you know, and I thought we would lose that. Like, how could anything be funny anymore? She, you know, and it just wasn't that way at all.
She hit on me.
Who?
Not Emma.
Mom?
Yeah. You're laughing. Don't laugh.
I'm sorry.
That's not, no. I'm freaking traumatized. My face.
I know. Well, I mean, that's what we did when things like that happened. Like, you know, we would just, what else can you do?
Yeah.
And she would laugh. She was so graceful about it. She just...
Better or worse? Sickness and health. Death do you part. That is the promise.
I think the revelation in this film is Robert Forster. You're ready for him to be the clueless, in denial guy who's just going to sort of be the obstacle to things moving ahead. And he turns out to be so much more than that.
Robert is perfect. You know, the role was inspired by really my grandfather and the way that he cared for my grandmother. And yeah, he was in total denial. But he was also bound and determined that, like, that he would not live without her. And that they would not be separated and that no one could care for her the way that he could. And in a way, he's right. You know, that's the hard thing. There's no right answer. And there's no real antagonist. So the only antagonist is really time.
"15 months without this face."
A fine cast explores the strains of family separation during wartime, the intense bonds forged on the battlefield, and the trauma that accompanies a return to normal life in the epic drama Indivisible.
"I want to know why. I want to know why you somehow have it in you to show up for those men when you refuse to do it for your own wife and kids.
If those men need me,
I need you."
Justin Brunig is Darren Turner, a U.S. Army chaplain dispatched to keep up the spirits of a unit fighting in 2007 Iraq. Sarah Drew plays his wife, and Jason George is the neighbor and fellow soldier who helps rebuild their shattered relationship. And yes, all three are longtime co-stars of the TV series Grey's Anatomy, and that may help explain the easy chemistry they share on screen. Indivisible is a faith-based film, which means it takes the message the chaplain brings to the battlefield dead seriously. But the movie doesn't blink at the profound questions of faith in the face of carnage. In the end, even the film's believers have to deal with the relationship between faith and doubt, and the possibility that faith without doubt may not be faith at all.
I trusted in God to protect those men, and he did!
No, you trusted in God to do what you thought he ought to do.
You're looking particularly beautiful tonight.
Ching.
Rowan Atkinson returns for the third time as a bumbling British secret agent in Johnny English Strikes Again. I wish I could say the third time's the charm, but like the first two installments, this one seems tired even before the first gunshot. Atkinson is an ingenious physical comic, and that's why the film can never stay completely unfunny. But really, it's been nearly 60 years since the first James Bond film. We've pretty much run out of new ways to make fun of them.
I'm not sure I've ever met a man quite like you.
Let me clear up the uncertainty for you. You haven't.
One of the year's best movies comes to DVD and Blu-ray this week. Here are my home video quick hits.
No.
This is telemarketing.
Stick to the script.
Let me give you a tip. You want to make some money here? Use your white voice.
My white voice.
Hey, Mr. Kramer. This is Langston from Regal View.
Nothing will prepare you for the off-the-wall brilliance of first-time director Boots Riley's dystopian comic masterpiece, Sorry to Bother You. Lakeith Stanfield plays a sad sack telemarketing guy who finds himself elevated to super seller, but what he's selling is no set of kitchen knives. Combine the best things about Office Space, Get Out, and add a dash of Pinocchio, and you've got a modern classic.
You are awesome.
Oh yeah!
And I Think We're Alone Now, Peter Dinklage continues to prove himself an actor who elevates the level of everything he touches. Here, he's apparently the last man on Earth, and he settles into a contented solitary existence, which is spoiled by the arrival of a woman, played by Elle Fanning.
Has anyone ever told you you're kind of a weird guy?
Yeah, but they're all dead now.
One of Schlockmeister Roger Corman's most notorious cheapo horror flicks is The Wasp Woman, now on Blu-ray. I chatted with comedian and bad film buff Dennis Miller about The Wasp Woman, and he told me he loves the way Corman's stoic actors always manage to keep a straight face.
It's funny that you see people turn up in these films throughout. Like, I know the guy who comes in and plays the doctor who helps him with the cosmetics. His name is Michael Mark. And they must have just had some sort of floating repertoire company of people who could do films and keep a straight face. Say, Corman would say, I've got 18 days to rip through this. I need somebody who's not going to crack up when Susan comes in with the bad wasp mask on.
Well, that's our podcast. For more on the movies, come to SaturdayEveningPost.com/movies. And for all my reviews, interviews, and videos, come to my website, moviesfortherestofus.com. For the Saturday Evening Post, I'm Bill Newcott.